60 minutes about Agile. And for those of you for whom it isn't already bleedingly obvious, this kind of metaphor of dragons, they put them on old maps in places where they didn't know what else to put, or they thought there might be unknown problems and so on. And so that's the metaphor I'm using. In scaling Agile, you might run into some dragons. So we'll talk about some of those in the next one. So with the dragons out of the way, let me introduce myself for those of you who don't know me. I'm a Scrum coach and a Scrum trainer. Less well known as a Kanban coach, but we do quite a lot of Kanban these days. I've written a little book. I've got a few copies here, which you're welcome to take, called Do Better Scrum. This is the third version, and it's somehow expanded from the original. It was about 30 pages, about 80 pages now. And I'm busy co-writing with Siggy Kaltenecker, who's an organizational development coach, a focus on leading self-organizing teams, both of which are going to be published by InfoCube Part 2, but they'll still remain free. And what I really do day to day is I try to help organizations become more agile. So I do want to kind of really at the beginning emphasize that for me, agile is not about doing agile, it's about being agile, learning to become agile and make your business better as a result. Agile isn't the goal, better business is the goal. Nevertheless, we want to talk specifically about scaling today. So the frame of my plan for this session is in four sections. So firstly, we need to understand what is this thing that we call scaling and why would we do it, and when should we perhaps not do it? Secondly, what I call some laws about scaling, so some truths that people have written about and I've observed in the years that I've been doing this that one could call laws, laws as in observable properties. Then thirdly, some patterns. I'm going to share with you 10 patterns, simple patterns in the scaling area. I'm not trying to make this stuff rocket science. I'm really trying to come down to some quite vanilla basics, things that work. So for those of you who are very advanced in this stuff, maybe there's nothing new for you in here. We'll see. For those of you who are kind of starting out in this thing, I hope that you can find something useful to take away. And then lastly, because this was designed originally as a kind of workshoppy thing, we only have an hour today, so there's not going to be too much workshop, but nevertheless, I'm going to see if we can, with this rather messy throng in the room, do a little bit of digestion and feedback and see what you have learned and what you can share from your experience. Okay, let's get started. All right, so why do we scale? So the first thing that I want to do is to get you engaged. Firstly, I just want to know answers to these two questions. How many people in your organization right now are currently involved in some kind of scaled product development, agile product development or project? And secondly, on a scale of 1 to 5, how successful have they been? 5 means everything is fantastic, we don't have any problems, and 0 means, I want to jump off a bridge, and, 2 or 3 means something in between. And we'll try and plot them up here. So I'm really just going to give you about 2 minutes, just turn to your neighbor and answer those two questions, and then I'm going to ask for some input.
Thank you.
some fallouts. Somebody who thinks the results are really awesome, then just put your hand up and tell me how many people involved. Scale 5. No? 4? Okay, how many people?
Just me, I think.
We have a humorous in the room. Yeah. How many people involved in your scale?
We have different teams, but the teams that are sort of sized 8, one team delivering an entire solution.
Just the total of people who are involved in your whole scale dev.
8 to 10.
Somewhere around there.
On the 4.
All right, somebody else on a 4.
Did you 3.5.
Yeah. 3.5.
Yeah. 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 Okay.
And 200 people.
Wow.
200 people.
So especially. Okay. Head from the Superman.
3.
So 40 people.
40 people. Okay. 70 people, somewhere there.
18?
18. Okay. Also 3, unless you tell me otherwise, I'm assuming these are all 3.
Mm-hmm.
50.
70.
Okay.
30.
Okay. No, that was there. Somebody else must have 60. I've made the dot already. Okay, what about lower? Less than somebody scoring less than Hurry.
Now we've got about 90, I would say about 2.
90, okay.
Can I just also differ to check what scaled agile product is
as opposed
to just agile?
Oh, we're going to get there. So we don't really know what we're surveying. I agree. Okay, any more data points, Justin?
Yeah, we've got about 50, I'd say about 1.
50, about 1.
We've got 70, it'd be 2.5.
70, 2.5, okay.
150 at about 2.
Okay, we've got some data points on there, so between size and success.
Bigger the size, the success.
Maybe. So let's see what I put on my slide. I don't really know, to be honest. One would be tempted to say more people, harder outcomes. And yet, I can't claim that there is real correlation with that. Like, there's correlation with other things that we'll see as we go through. Okay, so that kind of gets us started. So, the point that I want to talk about is when should we scale? And I would suggest that there are only two situations in which we should be scaling. So one is when, as I've got on there, when we're building a product that can't reasonably be built with a single Scrum team, so like 9 people, 10 people. If that really isn't feasible, then we're involved in a scale situation. And the second reason is when we've got a whole portfolio of products or projects to manage, and that also involves multiple people. I mean, you could feasibly do that with a single team in most organizations, not. And those are two legitimate cases, I believe, for scaling. Just to set the scene of what I don't regard as scaling is when we've got a situation like this, we've got a whole lot of customer projects that don't each need a full-size team, then my answer is just put them into one backlog. Scrum doesn't say you have to have a separate backlog for every product. It does say that you need to have a backlog, not more than one backlog per team. So if you want to run multiple projects through one team, then just put them all into backlog. So that's not a scaling problem in my book. The second thing, the other thing that isn't a scaling problem is when you've got multiple locations. So we recognize that we've got a distributed team, we're in multiple locations, and that's okay, and we will have some problems, particularly we'll have communication issues to deal with. But that's a different problem. That's also not a scaling problem. But the only problem that I'm dealing with here is when we've got really big products or we've got a whole lot of products that collectively make up a big amount of work, and we can't reasonably do that with a small number of people. So with that as the context, I'm going to suggest three laws of scaling. Okay, that's not two laws, that's number two. So the first law of scaling is this. Okay, seriously, you really should work hard with your team to become really good so that you don't need more than 9 people to build and sustain a product. And if you want a good example of it, the Bruno Quattro Pro project, which was a long, long time ago, pre anything that we knew as Agile, they had tried for a year and a half to build a product with 75 people and they failed. They then assembled a team of 9 people and they built the product in a year. So scale gets in your way. Scale costs time, scale costs money, scale costs energy. So the first point is try not to scale. Okay. Having said that, I know you're going to ignore it. And you are going to scale because that's why you're here. So the second law of scale from my ex-business partner and now learning partner, Marius de Beer. You don't get to pick what you scale. When you scale up, everything scales up with you. So that means both the good things and the problems. So when you scale, be aware that everything scales. So an example of that is every organization has got something we call culture. So there's the stuff that's visible with the tactics and the strategy. This is a slide from Michael Sahota, another Scrum coach. Below that, hidden between beneath the waterline, is this thing that we call culture. Okay, so what is culture? Culture is a set of assumptions by which that have emerged over the time, It really is the company's operating system, is what has made us successful. The things that we have found that have led to success become our culture, become embedded in our way of work. And that's true of scaling as well. So when we scale up, we're going to scale our existing culture. And the one thing we better do is be aware of culture. It's a bit of a busy slide, so I'll try and explain what it is. Another one from Michael Sahota. It's a model from a guy called William Schneider in a book called The Reengineering Alternative. And what he's got is, at the top and the bottom, is he's got really reality-oriented cultures versus possibility-oriented cultures, or present-oriented cultures versus future-oriented cultures. And on the sides, he's got on that side organization orientation or impersonal, and on this side, people orientation or personal. And if you understand those two axes, then you can map your culture onto these four quadrants that are directly labeled. Hello, mate. This was reversed, by the way. Which is, as you can hear from his accent, American. American. And a board member of the Scrum Alliance. So. Okay. So so what have we got? On the top right there, we've got a controlling culture. So we achieve success by getting and maintaining control. On the bottom right there, we've got a competence culture. So we succeed by being the best, by being good, by being individually good. You'll notice that in organizations that reward and foster individual competence and individual performance. Then on the top left, a collaboration culture. So we succeed by working together. And then a close cousin of a cultivated culture is that we grow people, and through people growing, we get our success. Now, there's no rocket science to realizing, if you understand that cultural model, that Agile really thrives in the left-hand side over here. Collaborative and cultivated cultures, Agile will thrive and might be a struggle in the right-hand side. What's quite interesting is, and what we see quite a lot, is when you have an organization with a predominantly controlling culture, you might do well starting with something like Kanban. Because Kanban says start where you are, respect current roles and processes and job titles, and so not really invading somebody's space. If they say, oh, you don't move my cheese because I'm a controlling kind of organization. And then likewise, the craftsmanship movement might fit well into the competence culture. So this is not meant to be a talk about culture. I'm just introducing this briefly here so that we understand that when we scale stuff, that this plays a role, this whole culture thing plays a role. Okay, so I want to get to the third law of scaling, and that's really going to be what leads us into the rest of the talk. So this, courtesy of Uncle Bob Martin, who you all know from his views on test-driven development or test-driven design, whatever name you prefer. If you want to go fast, you have to first go well. And so my whole message for you today really is, if you want to scale, make sure that you do it well in the small before you start trying to do fast by getting big. And so the patterns that I'm going to talk about now are really related to the third law of scaling, because that's the thing that you have control over. You don't have control over that everything scales, and we've already given up on the idea we're doing it with one team, so this is where we are. Okay. So, just before we get into the patterns, a couple of words on organizational principles. Firstly, you need to read these five books. That's only half a joke. I mean, you can choose other books, but these are quite good in the space of learning what to scale and what the effects are of scaling. The slides will be available, by the way, so you don't have to write everything down now. It's for you. The second thing that we need to understand is this thing called Conway's Law. So Mel Conway published this law in 1968, so way before anything Agile was known. And I'll just put it up there and let you read it. It seems complex at first, but it didn't really. So, essentially he's saying that if we build something, our organizational structure, or particularly the communication structure in our organization, is going to dictate where the fault lines are in what we build. So we want to look at this from the perspective of an architect. We want to turn it on the head and say, if we decide where we want the boundaries in our system, which is what we should be doing, then we better make our organization fit that. Now, we may not do that on day one, but we need to do that at some point. And the real point here also is that design, like everything else, especially in an agile world, is emergent. As you change stuff, so your design has to change and your design has to be refactored. And the point that comes out of this is you're going to have to change your organization also as you go on. So the organization can't be static if you want to achieve agility. And Craig Lawman, who is a lot ruder than I am even, if possible, writes these laws about organizations. So I've certainly experienced that. So what do we need to take out of Craig Larman's laws is what I said a moment ago. You have to change structure in order to bring about the behavior change that you want. And that, in turn, will lead to culture change if you need to have culture change. So, then the last thing before we get on to the patterns, I'm going to start with what I regard as potential anti-patterns, and then I'm going to get on to the patterns. Okay. So, I just want to say, be careful of over-defined oversimplified recipes, okay? They might be snake oil. Now, in the right hands, a framework like SAFe can be useful. It can be useful to start a conversation. However, if you think the picture there that you need every element of that thing and you don't know what to leave out, and that's the journey that you go forward, then you're in a dangerous space. So if you want to use it as a means to start a conversation and pick, I think this thing is good and I need it, and I don't need that thing, and you're competent to do that, or you engage somebody who's competent to do that, that might be helpful. Other uses might not. So just be careful that you don't end up with something that looks nice, but turns out to be just lipstick on the pig. Okay, so the things that I like are what's now become given the name LESS, that stands for Large Scale Scrum, from Larman and Roddy. Two of the books that I had on that earlier slide are about that. They're busy writing the third book at the moment, which I'm reviewing, and it's really good stuff because it's actually a prequel to the other two books, and it's easier to read it and explain stuff better. There's also a group of guys in Germany who I know have put together a principle-based set of principles, got board, you can see it over there. And then lastly, from Agile 42, a company based in Germany, they've got an enterprise transition framework, which is quite a good model, I think, and they've published it on their website. So I think there are some good tools out there, and this is by far not everything. I just think that I like. Okay, so on to the 10 patterns. So let me emphasize, these are patterns that work for me. You might find different ones. These are the ones that I've chosen that I want to share. They are broadly congruent with the large-scale Scrum framework. Not completely, but mostly. So pattern number one, you really need to have feature teams. You want to have long-lived teams that learn to work together, and that they must be constituted so that they can deliver end-to-end value. So that means they need to be cross-functional. Them, they need to have all the skills needed to do the work. Probably will require an organizational restructure. Most organizations starting out on an agile journey don't have this kind of team structure. Okay. Number two, there can be only one. So one backlog. Okay, so the principle here is feed multiple synchronized teams from a single backlog. It's a pattern that I've used over and over again. Some of you in this room have worked, we've used this pattern. So you do sprint planning together with a bunch of teams, you do sprint reviews together with a bunch of teams, you do sprint retros together with a bunch of teams with certain tweaks. And the only thing you do individually is the work in the sprint. And it sounds chaotic, and it works really, really well. The very first time I did it was with a Brave insurance company in Centurion, and I sat next to the CIO during the very first joint sprint planning session, about 50 people in the room, and the product owners were busy talking to the teams about the work, and I sat next to him and I said, Chris, how do you think it's going? It's kind of my heart in my mouth, because it was my first time of doing it. And he just was smiling from ear to ear. He said, this is the best communication we've ever had in our organization. For sure, there's a bit of a price to pay, and you've got to be able to facilitate it, but it works really well. Okay. Third pattern, which goes hand in hand to that, synchronized sprints. So if you want to really get the economies of scale, or you want to get the optimizing the whole, optimizing the bigger picture, then you want to synchronize the sprints for those teams. If you're running multiple teams, and you know, I'm one scrum master, I'm going to sprint planning for team A, and tomorrow I've got sprint planning for team B, and the next day I've got sprint planning for team C, and then the next day I've got the review and whatever, then you're on a treadmill and the teams aren't synchronized. you're optimizing your own time there, or maybe not even that. It's certainly not not a pattern that I think is worthwhile. So synchronize your sprints. Number four, you really want to keep, and you've heard this from other people today, you really want fast feedback. You want to get feedback to people on what is working and what isn't working. So you've got to integrate your stuff and test your stuff as early as possible. For those of you who worked on big projects, you have this kind of, at the end of the project, at a certain point in time, you have a hardening sprint or an integration phase or whatever you want to call it, and that's when all the little birdies come to roost. So you really, really don't want to do that. So continuous integration now for teams, especially doing stuff at scale, that's table stakes. The real journey now is into continuous delivery and continuous deployment. And luckily, there are books about it, as you can see. There's lots of good practice. It's not kind of impossible now to time. The earlier you start, the better. So that's really about, that's a technical skill as much as anything else. Number five. You need Slack in your system. Slack doesn't mean people lying around on the beach using Slack. Slack is a project management term about having some space in your schedule to go and learn stuff and get better. Jeff Sutherland has published a set of patterns called teams that finish early accelerate faster. So that might sound counterintuitive, so it's okay when teams say, we're only going to take on this amount of work, the sprint. Get over the fear that they're a lazy bunch of bums who don't want to do a decent day's work, and accept the fact that they actually want to and need to invest some time in improving and getting better. Evidence shows that when they finish early, they have time to go and work on improvements. And I strongly recommend Tom DeMarco's book, Slack, really help you understand why this stuff works. He's been in the industry a long time, and he's got a lot of good experience. Okay, number six, no silos. So how many of you have been in organizations where Joe is the only person on the planet who knows about System X? Plenty, right? Probably all of that. So we want to avoid that, because what happens when Joe gets written over by the big red bus? What happens when Joe is a really experienced, expensive person in our organization? The opportunity cost of him maintaining System X is really, really high. Why would we want to do that? We want to have tossed that work onto somebody who costs us much less money and free Joe to go and do something awesome for us. So we need to build skills in organizations. And in Scrum teams, the beauty of this idea of this cross-functional team is that we build these things called T-shaped people. And my observation is it happens almost magically or osmotically, as Alistair Coburn calls it. You just get a bunch of people together in a room working on stuff. They learn from each other, and if they start to understand that they're actually pairing and swarming to solve a problem together rather than me sticking in my own silo, these things solve themselves as long as we get out of the way.
Sorry, Peter.
Yeah.
How do you do that with a team that's not co-located?
Co-location just adds expense to the communication. So, I mean, you can do pair programming as a distributed pair. There are people who do that. So you can do anything distributed, it's just harder. I think, does that answer your question?
Yes, that's
cool. Okay, so the thing here is that the financial director doesn't, or the CFO doesn't know the risk that is on us having silos of knowledge. So there's a strong economic argument for it. Okay, number seven. We're more than halfway. Optimize the whole. What do we mean by that? We want to optimize the overall project portfolio. Not my project is king and your project sucks. But what is really important for the organization? A book that I really like in the space is Johanna Rothman's Manage Your Project Portfolio. It's a couple of years old now, 2009, I think. Really good book. And kind of agnostic of whether you're using Scrum or Kanban, she's not really talking about that. She's talking really about principles from a project perspective. If you want to know more about the process stuff, then I would recommend go and have a look at Klaus Leopold's portfolio Kanban. So he calls it Kanban and its flight level. So portfolio Kanban is called Kanban at flight level 4. A really good explanation on his website. He's a trainer that we bring out here regularly. In fact, he's in Joburg right now doing Kanban training. And he's going to be doing advanced work on this on Thursday, Friday. So, manage the whole portfolio. Number 8, of course, quality. I did refer to testing and integration earlier, but it goes deeper than that. We really need to make sure that we are not growing technical debt. We know that if we delay fixing a defect, it costs more when we fix it in a couple of weeks' time because we've forgotten what we did. We've now got to go and target switch, context switch, and we've got to go and remind ourselves, what did we do there? And when it's 6 weeks, you know, then we might as well be a different person. Did I even write that code? So you really want to be making sure that this is dealt with early. Fix errors, do refactoring, because when you do this at scale, the impact is even bigger. Two more to go. Kind of obvious, but really needs mentioning, I think, is communication. You need to really pay attention to this. When you've got a number of Scrum teams running, or Kanban teams, or whatever, a number of small teams running, each of those teams over there, you need to be able to synchronize between them. You want to have these feature-based teams so that we minimize dependencies. However, you can't get rid of dependencies completely. There will always be dependencies. So you need mechanisms to deal with that kind of thing. So you might have a scrum of scrums, for example, and I want to emphasize a scrum of scrums is not a meeting of scrum masters. I don't know where that misconception is. A scrum of scrums is a meeting of team members so that they can deal with inter-team dependencies. They are the people doing the technical work. They are the right people to deal with that. Scrum master is not a good proxy for the team to go and meet to resolve technical dependencies. You can, of course, have a meeting of Scrum masters to go and learn from each other. That's awesome. That's a community of practice. You can do the same thing with product owners or testers or anything else. So the point I'm trying to make here is you need to amplify the communication structures when you're working at scale. Some of them can be informal and some of them might need to be formalized. Point number 10, and the last one, is learning. We really need to pay attention to learning. And this really goes to guys like Peter Senge, the idea of the learning organization, knowledge sharing, those kinds of things. So build structures in your organization to do that. Possibly the best, least publicized example on the planet at the moment is Spotify. For those of you who don't know, it's a music streaming company. There's some excellent videos on, there is a paper by Henrik Nieberg on how they've scaled at Spotify. There is also a couple of videos called Agile, called Engineering Culture at Spotify. There's two of them. I really, really recommend that you watch them. I use them in my training courses. They're awesome. Watch them with your whole team and have a conversation about them. So they're a very agile organization, and yet they still recognize that they've got a long way to go and a lot of things to improve. So they're a good example. Okay, so that's 10 scaling patterns, and for those of you with a short memory span, there's a reminder of what they are. And now I want to invite you two. Now, how are we going to do this? Just form groups of three or four. Try and make them small because you can have a conversation. I don't know how you're going to do that, but self-organization is magic. This will happen. So four groups of three or maximum four, and try to answer these two questions. So what resonates with me of what I've heard, and what could I apply? What could I use? And maybe you want to share some experience you've got, which maybe an application of those patterns, or maybe outside of those patterns. So do that digestion, and then I'd like each group, a spokesman from each group, just to give us a sentence or two of feedback. So we won't have time to hear everybody's story about how their grandmother is scaling Scrum. We would like to share some of the insights that you guys have.
Peter, could you maybe just put the slide on the previous one?
Sure.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay.
I'll cover on this one.
Sounds like
culturally, you know, as a teacher, you know that you're succeeding if your whole class is talking while you're trying to teach. That's apparently a successful learning immediate process. I don't know if anybody can verify that. But it kind of feels a bit like that, yeah. A lot of conversation going on, so that's awesome. So let's have some sharing. I'm going to time box it, so we'll see what we can get through. Who wants to start?
So we thought with the synchronization of sprints that sprint planning, one, is a useful thing to do together, as is the retrospective, but that for sprint planning two and the retrospective, it might be better to split that between the teams or have the teams do that separately to avoid people getting disengaged. Just because when you're dealing with a group of 30 people, it could be difficult to make sure that everyone's voice is heard, everyone's problem is solved, and they don't design things that they're not actually focused on at that moment.
I'm just making a note for myself, because if there's time, I'll add a comment.
Cool.
So, you know, I just wanted to share something like what happened in classes. So, you know, it's scaled agile. I mean, I could be pretty much doing all of the stuff you've spoken about, but there was this whole thing of like, if we need to go faster, we need to scale. So instead of addressing the underlying issues, like you said, we also like scale. So we're just adding teams and teams and teams on top of, instead of addressing underlying issues. So I think that's definitely a danger of thinking that we need to scale. You don't. So, yeah, so I guess what I could apply is to scale.
Yeah, I need to go back to one team and get them to be really awesome.
So some of the things that we discussed, the problems around like creating feature teams and silos still existing inside of those teams. So you take people from different component teams, you put them into the single team, but then those people still sort of hang on to their particular silo, and there's quite a lot of resistance both from the team as well as the organization to cross-skill, to take the time to pair program. You know, people just, for some other reason, don't seem to want to do that, and obviously it's seen as waste. This is just going to take more time to get that right, which is a bit frustrating. And then we also spoke about the single backlog concept and the sort of challenges there, trying to get multiple stakeholders to try and now talk to each other to prioritize work on the single backlog. And often that becomes quite a big fight, and people aren't really willing to, you know, everything always has to be priority one and multiple priority ones to prioritize that.
Okay, thank you. One of the questions that came up in our discussion was, so how do we do relative estimation and then also allow enough time to, if there is a difference in voting per team, keeping in mind you're going to have multiple teams depending on how many teams you have, to ask the relevant questions to those who are not voting the same number. Okay, so why do you think it's a 5 and why do you think it's a 13? And actually have allowed time for those discussions, and then you know, do that properly for every single team without everybody in the room going, you know, because devs get bored.
Okay. We've seen that trying to have a feature team fully fledged in terms of the skill set, it tends to still naturally split into two for us in terms of back end and front end. Although we do have a very solid single backlog that we work from. We are synchronized in the sprints itself, and also we do faster feedback resonance with us as well in terms of integration at the end of every sprint. But I do see that we need to, you know, make you know, a bit more open in terms of not creating silos. I think that's something that can happen quite easily. And possibly to have retrospectives that's also meant for the whole team, for everybody.
We found the idea of having Slack quite interesting and really liked it, but it's a bit challenging to try and aim correctly for that.
Yeah. can't read that, right?
We also spoke about silos, how we find that silos have existed in our teams, even though we say we're doing Scrum and Agile, we already have silos. And one suggestion was to have peer reviews or code reviews in, so that people start to share knowledge about the stuff, about the actual different pieces of the code. And another thing was forcing different people to take on that silo in a different sprint, to start getting that fireball of everyone sharing the knowledge.
Both awesome ideas. The first one is one of the techniques they use at Spotify, and the second one is a technique I've used in clients.
We just discussed the principle of one platform. Encouraging businesses to make sure that they really know what is their first priority for the most across various products and various features, which would encourage communication. And also the discipline of including Slack, encouraging that they have leads and tech leads to pull that into the sprints and to the cultural development.
Two different technologies operating at the same time, but towards the same goal. We should possibly have one backlog for them and have sprint plans together, like at least SP1 together. Maybe just the question comes in, if they're a different team with different point systems, how does one do that?
Okay, it was a similar question to we had earlier, unifying the estimation.
I want to say something about that number four, fast feedback, where in my experience I think that a lot of these other things are actually very difficult to do unless you implement certain engineering practices such as continuous integration and some level of automated testing, etc. It becomes much, much, much more difficult if you don't.
I completely agree. I'm maybe contradicting myself, because the goal isn't to do Agile, the goal is to be Agile. But to be Agile, you have to do Agile first. And I don't think you can do Agile unless you automate a whole lot of stuff. I think you're kidding yourself. If you think you can go and manually regression test a whole code base on which 50 people are working and do that effectively every 2 weeks, it might be offensive, but it's, testing, that's not how it works anymore. In the 90s, we used to debate about should we automate this test or not, what's the cost and what's the benefit. Today, it's not a debate. Okay. All right, let me pick up on one or two things over here. The sprint planning too, the pattern that I use is I keep all the teams in the room doing sprint planning too. However, each team is seated at their own table, much like we've got in this room over here. If we had six teams and we have six tables, it's one team per table. During SP1, they're pulling from the product owner, or product owners are at the front of the room, and the teams are pulling from the backlog. And they're saying, we'll do that. Our dance card is already full, so then maybe we'll do something that isn't that familiar to us, but maybe you can help us. So that kind of self-organization happens in SP1. In SP2, they're all heads down doing their own sprint planning part two. They're doing it in one room together, so that when there are dependencies, when they emerge during SP2, they can go and figure out between the teams, maybe we shouldn't do that story, maybe you should do that story, because there's some dependencies that are going to trip us up. If there are architects who, maybe some organizations have maybe a senior architect who isn't embedded on a team, who kind of roves around and can kind of pollinate the teams and hear what they're saying and help to resolve dependencies, I've seen that pattern work quite well. It's got to be the right attitude. Not you guys are all idiots, here's the solution. It's more like, that's really interesting, have you thought about this? So that's really helpful when you have everybody in the room. And if the product owners need to answer questions, then they can be available. So, yes, it's done separately, and it's done in the same room. So, for me, that's the best way. And then as far as the retro is concerned, I like to kind of swing the changes. So the teams will retro individually in their teams, and then they will have a joint retro of what is it that we need to share between us that needs to be learnt across all of us. So usually the first will take place and then the second take place. So you kind of split the time between the two. Another pattern is to every now and again run what I call an affinity-based retro. So get all the testers to retro together, all the devs to retro together, all the designers retro together, so that they talk about design stuff or test